Tomorrow at 7 p.m. we will have the second sequel of the tutorial, because I realized that some questions were not covered towards the end. Right? We'll cover those questions tomorrow, and Dr. Nigam has kindly agreed to finish off the tutorial questions. And the solutions to the tutorial will not be guessed on. Okay?
Is it Friday?
Friday ko kya?
Friday
ko
kya?
Nahi. कल मुश्किल है। ओह फ्राइडे को मुश्किल है। ऑलराइट, सो नाउ व्हाट वी गोइंग टू लुक एट टुडे इज वी गोइंग टू फिनिश ऑफ आवर डिस्कशन ऑफ स्पिन हाफ ऑपरेटर्स एंड एवरीथिंग विल स्टार्ट मेकिंग सेंस टुडे। ऑलराइट, सपोज वी हैव द ऑब्जर्वेबल्स एस एक्स एस वाई एंड एस सी व्हिच आर द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ the spin angular momentum for the spin. Associated with each of these observables are operators. And we've noticed that Sx is proportional to the Pauli operator sigma x. Sy is proportional to the Pauli operator sigma y. And Sz is proportional to the Pauli operator sigma z. And when written in the Zeeman basis, these Pauli operators go as follows. Sigma x is 0, 1, 1, 0. Sigma y is 0 minus iota, iota 0. Sigma z is 1, 0, 0 minus 1. So this is how the Pauli operators are defined. And these operators, of course, when I write matrices, the natural question you should ask, what's the basis? What's the representation? The basis is the Zeeman basis. And the Zeeman basis states are the states plus z and minus z. Okay? And these states are the eigenstates of the Sz operator. Right? So Sz acts on plus z to give you the same state with a certain eigenvalue, and that is h bar over 2. And Sz acts on minus z to give you the same state with the eigenvalue minus h bar over 2. Plus h bar over 2 and minus h bar over 2 are the values of the z component of the spin. When you measure them in an experiment, they are the measurement outcomes. Okay. So this is something that we finished off in the previous lecture. And this was just meant to be a refresher. Now let's look at the commutator between Sx and Sy. Now why are we interested in the commutators? Because we are interested in the indeterminacy relation. So we would like to find out what's the commutator between the different operators. So if you look at Sx commuted with Sy, this is simply Sx Sy minus Sy Sx. And now what you could do, you could put in the values for the, you could represent these operators in the basis, and you can compute what this output is going to be. Alright? For example, if I were to perform this calculation in a certain basis, I would like to put Sx and Sy and S, all of these operators in the same basis. So I choose the Zeeman basis. Sx would be h bar 2 sigma x, Sy would be h bar 2 sigma y minus h bar 2 sigma y, h bar 2 sigma x. Now these factors of h bars and 2s are just numbers. I have sigma x, Pauli matrix x, sigma y minus sigma y, sigma x. So this is the commutator between the spin operator x and the spin operator y. We can find out what this operator is. Now there are two ways of doing this. I would like to highlight both methods. Method number one. I can express these poly operators in explicitly in the Zeeman basis. So, sigma x, sigma y, minus sigma y, sigma x, represented in the Zeeman basis becomes this matrix multiplied by the sigma y matrix minus sigma y matrix multiplied by the sigma x matrix. Okay. This turns out to be iota 0 0 minus iota minus iota 0 0 iota, right? This is 2 times iota 0 0 minus iota, right? This is simply 2 iota into sigma 0. Hence, the commutator of Sx to Sy turns out to be h bar square over 4 2 iota sigma 0. This just cancels out. I have h bar iota sigma z over h bar, right? This is what I get. Okay. But this is equal to iota h bar s z. So the commutator of Sx with Sy is iota times h bar times the third spin operator, Sz. The second method in which we solve this commutator is as follows. Is this clear? Is this method clear? It's a straightforward algebraic calculation. Okay? Now the second method is to represent sigma x in the form of outer products. Now if you look at this expression, by looking at this expression, you can state that sigma x just equals the z operator in its outer product with minus z plus minus z outer product with z. Is this something that comes naturally to you? Does it? No, it doesn't. So let me explain this. I know that in a Zeeman basis, ket z is 1, 0. Okay? And ket of minus z is 0, 1. These are the two eigenstates in the Zeeman basis. So the corresponding bras are plus z equals the row vector 1, 0 and minus z equals the row vector 0, 1. So if I form the outer product plus z with itself, what do I get? I get 1, 0, 1, 0 and this is just 1, 0, 0, 0. Plus z is orthogonal to minus z. So these two vectors are orthogonal vectors. This is just like the horizontal polarization, this is just like the vertical polarization. Is this clear? So if you have an element here, this outer product represents an operator. And it has in a certain representation the form of a matrix. The matrix is such that there is 1 in this position and 0 everywhere else. And you can easily check that. If this is an operator and you want to find what this element is going to be, so this element is simply going to be the operator plus z sandwiched between plus z and plus z, and this is 1. Okay. Now if you take the same operator plus z out of product with itself and you would like to find out what this element is going to be, what do you do? You sandwich between plus z and minus z, and the answer is going to be 0. Likewise, you can show that this is 0, this is 0. Hence, this outer product is represented by this matrix.
Can you repeat that?
What did you get?
यहाँ से आगे आपने मैट्रिक्स से कैसे बनाएंगे?
देखो, यहाँ से ये बात क्लियर होगी?
नहीं, ये आप
ये भी क्लियर नहीं हुआ?
नहीं.
ये क्लियर है?
हाँ.
ये क्लियर है? ये क्लियर है? ये क्लियर है? Now I want to form this outer product. Now this is a ket, this is a bra. The ket corresponds to the column vector, the bra corresponds to the row vector. So you perform this multiplication, you get a matrix. Now this matrix is such that there is 1 in this position and 0 everywhere else. So this matrix is the representation of this outer product. This outer product must be an operator. Okay, because it is represented by a matrix. Okay. So this equals this matrix. But it is represented by this matrix. And you can also check that. Now I am doing an additional check here. If I take this operator plus z minus z and I would like to find out what the first element is in the first row and the first column. Now I have ordered the states such that the first row and the first column will have an element which is equal to the operator, whatever that is, sandwiched between plus z and plus z. And this stands out to be 1. So this is an additional check on what we've done over here. All other terms will be 0. This matrix element will be 0. This matrix element is going to be the operator plus z sandwiched between minus z and plus z. Right? Of course this is going to be 0 again. Likewise you can show that this term is going to be 0. Remember that if you have an operator A and you want to find the ijth element of that operator, what would you do? Would sandwich the operator A between I and J. Right? And this is what I've done here. Okay? Agree? Samajh aa gaya? Shah Asad Alam, aapko samajh aaya? Baki? Aapko samajh aaya? Isi tarah. So sigma x is now this element plus this element. Now one can show that if ket z, bra z is this, then plus z, bra minus z is just going to be, now this is a ket, so it's 1, 0. This is the bra, which is this bra, 0, 1. And the result is 0, 1, 0, 0. So this outer product is this operator. It's this matrix. Okay? Likewise, minus z plus z is also going to be an operator, so it must have a matrix representation, which is this. Minus z, an outer product will have a matrix representation given by this. Hence, if this is sigma x can be written as 0, 1, 0, 0 plus 0, 1, 0, 0. Right? Now what is this? This is simply z out of product with minus z plus minus z out of product with z. Okay, so this is sigma x in the outer product form. Okay. Likewise, sigma y is going to be minus iota plus z minus z plus iota minus z plus z. Right? Look at this. This is minus iota into this operator plus iota into this operator. Likewise, sigma z is going to be, could you tell me what sigma z is going to be when I write this as an outer, sum of outer products?
Delta plus z and gamma plus z and same for minus.
Minus, with the minus here, right? Remember that this is not a spectral decomposition. This is representing the Pauli operators as outer products, as a sums of outer products. Okay? Now with this prescription, I can find out what sigma x, sigma y is going to be. Sigma x, sigma y is just going to be, now what is sigma x? Plus z minus z plus minus z plus. Now this acts on sigma y. What is sigma y? Sigma y comes from here. I put all of this here. Minus I plus z plus I minus z plus z. Okay, and the result is something. It's now this operator acting on this state, on this operator, if I put this operator together with this operator, what's the result? If this operator acts on this operator, what should I get? Zero. Is someone there? Two zero. चलो पहले ये लिख लो एक मिनट देता हूँ आपको ये समझ लो ये लिख लो compositions, this should be plus z, this should be minus z, then this should be minus z. This is not a spectral decomposition. ठीक है चलो आगे calculate the product of sigma x and sigma y. So I write the sigma x in the form of outer product as I've derived here and sigma y as I've derived over there. Now I would like to make this operator act on both of these operators and this operator acts on both of these operators because of the distributive property. So when this operator acts on this operator, what result should I get? Look at these operators. Zero. Because now this state is orthogonal to this state, so the inner product is going to be zero. But when this operator acts on this operator, the result is iota plus z, right? It's not one. The product of two operators should be an operator, not a number. Okay. Now this operator acting on this operator gives me minus iota minus z plus z. Okay, this operator acting on this operator gives me zero. Okay, likewise I can find sigma y multiplied by sigma x and then I can subtract and when I subtract I will get the same result. Okay, so these are two methods for doing problems of this kind, you can explicitly write down the matrices in a particular basis and perform matrix multiplication. The other possibility is to write these operators as the sum of outer products and then acting and then looking at the action of one operator on the other. You should get identical results. But the key result is profound. Nothing less than profound. And what is the result? That if I have SX operator and I want to find the commutator with SY. Now these are two spin operators. The commutator is not zero. It's rather equal to iota times h bar sz. The third spin operator. This is something very profound and it has huge implications as we will learn. Likewise, if I want to find the commutator between sy and sz, the result is going to be iota h bar times the other commutator, sx. If I want to find sz commutator with sx, the result is going to be iota h bar into sy. Okay? What is the commutator between sx and sx? What's the commutator of any spin operator in itself?
Zero.
If I have two operators A, B and I find their commutators and I reverse the order and I find their commutators, what's the relationship between this commutator and this commutator?
Minus.
It has to be minus, right? This means that if this were sy and this were sx, this would be minus iota h bar sc. Look, x, y and z are appearing in a special order. X, y and then z. Y, z and then x. Z, x and then y. So all three of these commutation relationships are often summarized by writing s, x commutator with s, y gives you iota h bar s, z and all its cyclic commutations. Cyclic commutations. So I draw this arrow, which is clockwise, put the three numbers x, y, z. Commutator of x and y gives me z. Commutator of y and z gives me x. But if I go reverse to the direction of the arrow, the commutator of z and y will give me minus x. Okay? So all of this that I've written here is often summarized in this manner. Okay? And there's yet another way of summarizing this information. S alpha commutator with s beta is given by iota h bar Levi-Civita symbol I, J, K, S, oh sorry, factor, alpha, beta, delta, S, K. Now this is a special symbol, just like a Dirac delta function. This function or tensor or symbol is called a Levi-Civita symbol, and it is such that alpha, beta, gamma, they can be x, y or z, and this number is 0 if any two of the symbols are equal to one another, okay. And it's equal to 1 if alpha, beta and gamma appear in the same order as here. This is gamma by itself, as gamma. And this is minus 1 if alpha, beta, gamma do not appear in the order of x, y, and z. So if alpha, beta, gamma are cyclic permutations of x, y, and z, this is plus 1. If alpha, beta, gamma are not cyclic permutations of x, y, and z, this is minus 1. If any two symbols match, this is 0. So this is just a short presentation and we need not worry about it too much in time. Something that we need to remember is this commutation relationship. Okay? Now what are the implications of this commutation? They are far-reaching. We learned the indeterminacy principle. What the indeterminacy principle tells us is that if you have two operators and you would like to measure those operators on different but identical copies of the quantum state that we prepared, then the spread in the values of one of the observables, say Sx, multiplied by the spread in the measurement outcome of the other variable, delta Sy, this must be equal to or greater than 1 over 2 times the modulus of the expectation value of the commutator of these operators. Right? Indeterminacy principle. Last class. See you now. Have you noticed that? Now what we are doing, we are preparing identical copies, but different copies of a spin system, spin half system, and we are measuring x and then we are measuring y, Sx and Sy, on different copies of the same system, identically prepared systems. Then there will be some spread or some indeterminacy in the value of Sx and some indeterminacy in the value of Sy, and when we take this product, this product is bound towards the lower side. It must be greater than something. And that something is the expectation value of the commutator of these, of the Hermitian operators associated with these measurement objects, of these observables. Now we derive that the commutator of Sx and Sy, so this is greater than 1/2 modulus of the commutator is iota h bar s z, right? Now this means that delta s x, delta s y have to be greater than or equal to h bar over 2, and expectation value of s z. The expectation value of a Hermitian operator is always real, so I don't need to put this sign again and again.
Expectation value is a meaning of operator.
Yeah.
Why do we need expectation value of meaning?
The expectation value is the mean of the measurement outcomes. इसका मतलब ये है कि this product cannot be equal to zero. It is lower bound by S Z, by the expectation value of S Z. This product can only be zero if the expectation value of S Z is zero. Let's look at an example, and then we'll have more to say about this in a short while. Suppose I prepare spins in the state Z, okay? For example, these are spins pointing up, parallel to the magnetic field. So they're in the state plus Z. Let's find out the expectation value of SZ. So the expectation value of SZ, given this quantum state, right? Given this quantum state, is simply SZ sandwiched between the state. Okay. Now what is this? What is the result for this? What is the expectation value? What is this expectation value?
1, 2, 3.
What's the eigenvalue? So this is an eigenstate of SZ. So when this operator acts on its eigenstate, you get the same state but with the eigenvalue. The eigenvalue is h bar over 2. Probability होगी S G acting on G, ठीक है? कि probability क्या होगी? Now if the state is prepared 2 plus z and we measuring s z, what is the probability that you will end up with the state plus z?
1.
How do you find out that probability? The probability that you achieve the eigenvalue h bar over 2 given your input state is plus z. This probability intuitively, okay, I'll put that. So the probability, okay, let me move on. The probability that your measurement outcome is plus h bar over 2 given your input state is plus z. This is, what is this equal to? This is your input state plus z and you have want to find the inner product with the corresponding eigenstate. Which eigenstate has the eigenvalue plus h bar over 2 plus z?
Yes.
So you find the inner product, modulus, square it and 1. You get 1. And experimentally what's happening here is that you have a spin analyzer oriented along z. You input a state that is plus z anyway. So all the electrons will only take the plus z channel. This port will be totally empty. So the probability that the electron will end up in this state is going to be plus 1. So the probability is this value. Whereas, okay, now what does the expectation value tell you? Look at this expectation value. The expectation value is h bar over 2. So the average value, the average measurement outcome that you're getting is h bar over 2. This is your measurement outcome. Since your measurement outcome is always h bar over 2, so its mean value is also h bar over 2. Okay? Is the concept clearer, slightly clearer now? Okay. Now, for this input state, the right-hand side of the indeterminacy relationship gives you h bar over 2, and this expectation value is h bar over 2. So you get h bar square over 4. So your delta Sx and delta Sy, neither of them can be 0. Okay. Now what does this mean? Experimentally what does it mean? What does it actually mean in real life? It means that if you have an Sax operator, right, if you're measuring your spin along the x-axis, and you are inputting the same input state, plus z, there will always be some minimum uncertainty, some minimum spread, which means that your output can either go here or it can go here. So your output can be A, can be a, the measurement output could be plus h bar over 2 or minus h bar over 2. Here you're preparing the state x, here you're preparing the state minus x. So there is a spread in the values. Either you get this outcome or you get this outcome. If you just got one outcome, then there would be no spread in the values. And hence your uncertainty in Sx would be 0. But that's not allowed by the indeterminacy relationship. Which means that if you input the same state and analyze along x, there is going to be spread in the values. With the 50% probability, you'll get this output. With the 50% probability, you'll get this output. On identical runs of the experiment, half of the electrons will go here and half of them will go here. In half of the time, this state will be prepared, and in half of the time, this state will be prepared. So intuitively, if you look at the spread in the values of Sx that you're measuring, it's just h bar over 2. You're getting plus h bar over 2 half of the time, then minus h bar over 2 half of the time. So your spread is h bar over 2. Okay. It could be h bar, you, this is greater than or equal to, but h bar over 2 makes more intuitive sense. Dekho, delta Sx nikalna hai, kaise nikalenge delta Sx? Nikal ke dekho ki h bar over 2 aaya, delta Sx square is Sx operator squared expectation value minus Sx operator expectation value squared. Now you find this according to the recipe that I have written, you find out the uncertainty, you get h bar over 2. Isi tarah, agar main I use an Sa y, which means that I'm measuring the outcomes when I analyze the spins along the plus minus y axis, I use the same input state plus z. Still I will get a dispersion in the measurement outcome. I will produce plus y here, minus y here. The measurement outcome is again plus h bar over 2. It's again minus h bar over 2. Okay? And there will be spread. 50% of the times I will prepare this state, I will get this measurement outcome, 50% of the time I will get this outcome. So the spread in my S y, which I can compute using the same formula, replacing the S with the Y, is going to be H bar over 2 again. Or it could be, probably still H bar over 2, but in any case, this inequality will be satisfied. Janab sir.
So what if our input state is get 3 plus get minus 3 over?
Okay, you can exactly perform the same procedure. You just have to replace this at z with, now you're inputting the x state, right? So now the question Saad has asked, nice question, good exercise.
So because this can be the expectation value z would be 0.
Dekho, agar main input lekta hoon x, right? This is the input that you give, right? Now what do I want to measure? Suppose I want to measure I want to measure Sx and Sy at the same time. At the same time means I want to measure these variables on identical but different copies. So what would I need to do? I would need to do delta Sx, delta Sy must be greater than or equal to h bar over 2. Now the commutator between these is such that you get Sz. Expectation value of Sz. Now what is the expectation value of Sz in this input state? Question for everyone. So I have this input state, what is your expected value of Sz? Up to 0. Because this is really an Saz, it will split this x equally, means with an equal probability you will get plus z or minus z, right? With an equal probability. So the expected value is 0. The average of these will be 0. So this thing is going to be 0. And what we need to prove is that this value is at least 0. Alright, so what is delta Sx if I input this state? y1. If I have the get x as the input and I measure sx, will there be any spread in the measurement outcomes? No. So what is the spread?
Zero.
So this zero is still equal to zero. So you still satisfy the indeterminacy relationship. What this indeterminacy relationship is actually telling you is the following. It is telling you, okay, let me write down this relationship again. Delta Sx multiplied by delta Sy must be greater than or equal to h bar over 2 Sz. Right? Because Sz is the commutator of Sx and Sy. What is this telling us? This is telling us really that Sx and Sy, since the commutator is not zero, their indeterminacy or their spread in their value, the real of possibilities that we get for each one of them is bound on the lower side. It cannot go below a certain value. It has to remain above a certain threshold. So there has to be larger indeterminacy because the commutator is not zero, which means that Sx and Sy are incompatible observables. Alright, let me explain what this means. In the classical world, if I have an object that has a certain momentum p, this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis. Suppose this is just a classical particle and it's moving with a certain velocity, which is also the direction of momentum, and this p has an x component and a y component. I can accurately determine its x component, and that will not affect what the y component is going to be, because x and y are independent variables. The momentum along x is totally independent from the momentum along y. So in the classical world, px and py, which are the x and y components of linear momentum, they are compatible observables. But this breaks down for angular momentum, for quantum mechanics. And let me give you a reasoning of why does it break down. Suppose I have SAZ. Okay. And then I have another SAZ. Suppose I input a state plus Z. Now, is this here an eigen state of Sz? Yes, it is. So there is no indeterminacy. The expectation value is plus h bar over 2 and the delta Sz is 0. So I always get this state that is populated. The other channel is always empty. Now I put this state in another Sz. I will always get a plus z output. Is that true? Why is this happening? Because the measurement operator, the von Neumann operator associated with this spin analyzer is Sz and it commutes with itself. But let me look at another example. Suppose I have an Saz followed by an Sax. So this is an Sax, this is an Saz. This is another Saz. Now the only difference between this case, this experiment and this experiment is that I've reintroduced an Sax. Right? That's the only difference that I've done. Now I input the same input state plus Z. With this analyzer, it's always, the output is always going to be plus Z. Probability 1, expectation value plus H bar over 2. Now I put this plus z into an Sax. What do I get as an output? I get plus x and minus x. Okay? The expectation value is now 0. But, and there is some indeterminacy. So I get both channels are populated. Okay, so I get a plus x here and a minus x here. Suppose I block this. I block this channel. Now this new state has been created. And this state is not the same as the state here. Which means that introducing an sx operator here, introducing an sx measurement operator here, has changed the z component of the state that we're talking about here. Here the state was only pointing along, it was a plus z state. But here the state has changed from plus z to plus x and minus x. So I've created a new state. And now if I put in this state into the s and z, I will get two outputs. I will get plus z and minus z. Which means that even though no minus z existed in my original state, there was no minus z in my original state. It did not have a projection along minus z. But at my output, I have created this minus z. And that is happening because I have introduced an observable in between that does not commute with. So I have introduced sx that does not commute with sz. Measuring the x component affects the outcome for the z component. Which means that the x component and the z component don't commute. They are incompatible observables. So this is what the indeterminacy relationship really means in a sense.
At that time, you can only measure one.
Measure कर सकते लेकिन indeterminacy हो और at the time में आपको बड़ा careful है at the time का मतलब ये नहीं कि in synchronicities at the time का मतलब ये है कि you repeat the experiment multiple times on the same input state you prepare many copies of the input state and repeat the experiment again and again because if you take this state or this state here is going to be different from the input state. You cannot perform a measurement again on this state. So performing a measurement or having some quantum operators placed in the path of the quantum system changes the state at every instrument. And it is not possible to measure the x and the y component of angular momentums together without one affecting the other. X, Sx, Sy, and Sz, all three are incompatible observables. However, if I place Saz, and I place as many Saz's as I want, I string them together, the result will be unchanged because the measurement operators all commute in between themselves. All the Sz's will commute with themselves. G.
So what does the Sx operator correspond to? Does it mean creation of plus x state or splitting of z into plus x and minus?
So this Sax along with this beam block is creating a new state. And with the help of Sx, I can find out what's the probability that this channel is going to be populated and what's the probability that this channel is going to be populated and how do I find out that out? I take the expectation value plus z. This will give me the mean value. Likewise, I can find delta sx. These are the two results that you need to find out what you get here. Okay, if I don't have this, this is just going to create delta x plus minus delta x, which is z. समझ आ रही है? जब तक आप कुछ नहीं पढ़ोगे, मैं आपको यकीन से दिला सकता हूँ। जब तक कुछ नहीं पढ़ोगे, घर जाके किताब हो या कोई किताब नहीं है जो खाली पड़ सके, उसमें आपको मुकम्मल तौर पर समझ नहीं आएगी। खुद प्रैक्टिस करने से समझ जाएगी। जी,
the gist of it is कि अगर आप x के बाद z के बाद एक और मेजर करते हो, आपने x In your after the second transformation, you're getting an x and a minus. So, excuse the same. The original value had no x or negative x. And because of this, it's really
plus z had plus x and minus x. But it had no minus z. But at the output, you're getting minus z because you prepared a new state in between. By the act of measuring along x, you've changed what you measured prior to that.
So, you're saying this in depth?
What I'm saying, what do you mean? What is incorrect?
What is the point? What are you trying to do?
I'm trying to measure Sx and Sy together and both of them with zero precision. I can't do that. Right? If I measure Sx and right, here I'm measuring Sz. What is the imprecision in Sz?
Zero.
Right? It's totally precise. Because for certainty I'm getting this output. With certainty I'm getting this output. But now if I try to measure Sx on the same system, right? I measured Sx on the same system, I am getting an uncertainty in Z again. By introducing this operator here, I'm getting an uncertainty in Z. Which means that I cannot measure Sx and Sz at the same time with zero, with infinite precision.
So Sanjay, should we have Z or enter Sz and measure Sx? आप ये जो बी मंत्र आ रही है इसके आप दो कॉपी आती भी उन्होंने भी इसमें आती नहीं चले तो इन वन एक्सपेरिमेंट यू आर गेटिंग एस जी और देन एस तो द अदर एक्सपेरिमेंट यू गेट एक्स नहीं गेट एक्स आप सारे वैल्यू मिल रहे हैं एस सी भी मिल रहा है सच में इधर आप लेट हो
सब को तो
इस ये वाली मिल रहा
है ये
जो स्टेट और आप इसकी कॉपी मिला है सिर्फ यहाँ पे
ठीक है
तो आपको डेल्टा एक्स की वैल्यू मिली है इसको डेल्टा एक्स वैल्यू मिली है
ठीक है
एस एक्स एस सी एस डेल्टा एक्स वगैरह क्या है यू आर गेटिंग व्हाट डिफरेंस है फिर भी कुछ नहीं बोलने को आई है यू आर मेकिंग अ मेजरमेंट तो आप इसकी एक सेपरेट ना दी हुई है आप एफ एक्स की मेजरमेंट तो जैसा मैंने कहा नहीं तो
लेकिन आपको अच्छा ये मेजर किया सी एक्स ठीक है इसमें तो आपको इंप्रेशन इन इसमें तो आंसर क्यों दिया आपके पास
आपको फिर एक्स की वैल्यू ना सर ये जो फनोमेना है प्रोबेबिलिटी बीइंग इंट्रोड्यूस्ड आप श्योर नहीं है कि किधर प्लस एक्स रेट पे जाएगा प्लस माइनस एक्स रेट पे जाएगा दिस इज व्हाट यू मीन बाय अनसर्टेनिटी इंट्रोड्यूस्ड
And then you measure SAC again, which means that the measurement outcome you are getting also contains an uncertainty in SAC. Here you have no uncertainty in SAC, but here you are getting an uncertainty in SAC.
Some of the coefficient you are
talking about. But it's not necessary, what's compatible observable to me? I'm not taking it. Look, I'm going to understand the question. If you have kept z as your input, right, and you're just measuring sz, you are with certainty getting this output. Now, if you input the same state on an sax, you're getting a plus x and a minus x. Now, this plus x contains in itself an uncertainty in sz as well. And how do you prove that? You put this state into a subsequent analyzer that is oriented along z, and this will give you two outputs. So this state that you have created by measuring Sx has now created an uncertainty in Sz. The z component of this state is indeterminate. It's imprecise. There are two possibilities. The realm of possibilities contains two values. So the z component of the angular momentum in this beam of electrons has now become indeterminate. Has become imprecise.
These two possibilities are only probabilistic. There is no way anybody can predict that it will be plus x or zeta.
Exactly.
This is what you mean by precision.
Exactly.
Just simply in a product, there is a probability. Now,
we will meet the probability. So, we will meet the probability. Certain you are saying, देखो अगर ये beam of input करें, you're certain that you will get this
result.
You're 100%, there's no uncertainty, but now you introduce an uncertainty, okay? Your result has become imprecise. There is some delta SC.
So, in states that the intrinsic process of uncertainty should be on those states, let's say it's composed of other states like the X, Y, Y.
Yeah, give me precise examples. All right. First of all, I'd like to address a few confusions. Because it's very important that we these confusions do not have the time to settle in your minds and unsettle you. First confusion is, if I say plus x state, right? And we're talking about spin half systems. How is it possible? What does this physically mean? Physically, it means that I have some axis x in the real space, an axis x in the real space, and I have an arrangement of magnets such that there is a field gradient. Suppose this is the direction of the field gradient, delta B. And spin half particles like electrons enter this region and they are deflected, say, in this direction, upwards. Okay. Now, these electrons, which have been deflected upwards, I call these electrons, each of these electrons exists in a state plus x. This direction in which the field gradient is applied is my x direction in my labeling scheme. The electrons are such that their magnetic moments will be parallel to x. So an electron whose magnetic moment is parallel to x is said to exist in this state plus x. I can call this axis what? The y axis. And this will be the label for this quantum state will be plus y. If I call this direction the z axis, then this label will be plus z. That's all there is to this nomenclature. Now if I have this quantum state and I put this inside another magnet which is oriented along some other axis, like the z axis, which now is at 90 degrees in the real space from the x axis, then what would happen is that these electrons would now take up two possibilities. They will either be deflected upward or downward. One of these states I would call plus z, and the other states I would call minus z. Hence, do not think that since I have prepared magnetic moments that are parallel to the x-axis, therefore, I cannot have any z component in the space. This is fallacious thinking. This thinking is at fallacy. Galati par hai aap aise soch rahe hain. Kyunki ab kya ho raha hai ki ab aapne ek aur magnet liya, uski inhomogeneous field ko tilt kar diya along the z axis. But the z axis is perpendicular to this x axis somehow. So I have physically reoriented the magnet. Now I am passing these magnetic moments whose magnetic moments are now along the previous x-axis, and now these magnetic moments are passing towards inhomogeneous magnetic field such that the field gradient is along the z-axis. So you will get two beams at the output. You will have prepared a photon, an electron either whose spin is parallel to this new z-axis or something that is anti-parallel to the new z-axis. Okay? So, do not think that since I have prepared a magnetic moment that is parallel to the x-axis, it cannot have a component along the z-axis or the minus z-axis. Okay. Does this satisfy you to an extent?
So, you are both the magnets be parallel to the z-axis.
Magnetic field gradient.
Gradient. And that prepares these states of plus z and minus z.
Yes.
So, why do we call it making an observation?
यार इसको ब्लॉक कर दो लेकिन ये मेन स्टेट पे है प्लस जी ओरिजिनली आप प्लस एक्स इन टू देयर बिकॉज़ इफ यू गेट द इलेक्ट्रॉन टू एग्जिस्ट इन दिस चैनल यू हैव प्रिपेयर्ड अ न्यू स्टेट दैट इलेक्ट्रॉन विल बी इन द प्लस जी स्टेट इफ एन इलेक्ट्रॉन इज नोन टू एग्जिस्ट इन दिस चैनल व्हिच मींस दैट यू हैव गेन्ड नॉलेज ऑफ द चैनल व्हिच पार्ट द इलेक्ट्रॉन इज टेकिंग दैट यू हैव प्रिपेयर्ड दिस स्टेट. So whenever you make an observation, you're doing a preparation. Okay? अच्छा अब देखो आप लोग x, y और z से बहुत confused हो रहे हो और मुझे उम्मीद है कि जो मैं मैं अब आपको बताने लगा इससे आपके शक को कुछ अफाका होगा, कुछ तसल्ली होगी। आमतौर पर जब हम क्लासिकल फिजिक्स में बात करते हैं, कि कार्टेशियन सिस्टम में बात करते हैं, आवर ऑर्थोगोनल एक्सिस आर द एक्स वाई एंड जेड एक्सिस, ओके, एंड अ यूनिट वेक्टर अलोंग एक्स विल बी ऑर्थोगोनल टू अ यूनिट वेक्टर अलोंग जेड, राइट, दिस डॉट प्रोडक्ट इज जीरो, एक्स डॉट जेड इज जीरो, बट वी सीन क्वांटम सिस्टम, वी सीन द पोलराइजेशन ऑफ फोटॉन्स, सो वी टॉक्ड अबाउट the horizontal and vertical states which form the basis for a two-dimensional Hilbert space, okay? So the polarization of a photon is a two-dimensional system, a two-dimensional quantum system, okay? Likewise, the spin of an electron or the spin of a photon, proton, neutron, nucleus, good, a spin half is also a two-dimensional system, okay? So you can choose a basis for this two-dimensional system. The basis that we normally choose which is the Zeeman basis is plus z and minus z, okay? Now physically, a spin that is along plus z, this quantum state has a magnetic moment along the plus z axis, and this quantum state corresponds to a spin to an electron that has its magnetic moment along the minus z axis, which means that the magnetic moments are anti-parallel. But in quantum mechanical terms, these quantum states are orthogonal. This is something you should realize, because now we're not talking in quantum mechanics, we're not talking about real spaces, we're talking about a Hilbert space. And when I say that these states are orthogonal, it really means that plus z in a product with minus z, even though physically they may correspond to spins pointing parallel to the magnetic field and anti-parallel to the magnetic field, because these magnetic moments are vectors, the quantum states associated with these spins are orthogonal in the Hilbert space. And what do I mean by orthogonality? What do I mean by orthogonality? I mean that if I prepare plus z, right, and I pass this to a spin analyzer oriented along z, the output would always be present around in this channel. The other channel will always be empty. This will be an empty channel. Therefore, preparing plus z, I have no chance of getting minus z, which means that the inner product of this state to this state must be zero. And this is what is meant by orthogonality. This is the original lectures that we've gone through. What do I mean physically by orthogonality? Is that if I prepare this, there is no chance of getting this out. The probability of getting this is zero. So the inner product of this with this is zero, and this is how we define orthogonal in real space. Okay? Now, there is a tool in quantum mechanics, which is often used in quantum computing and quantum information processing, that helps you visualize these states. Now, when you talk about Hilbert spaces, it's difficult to draw or visualize these spaces. Okay? But for two-dimensional Hilbert space, there is a tool that helps you gain some clarity in the mathematical operations. And that tool is called the Bloch sphere. So in the Bloch sphere, one draws a sphere. Okay? It's just a sphere. You get a sphere. Now the Bloch sphere is a tool that helps you visualize quantum states in a two-dimensional system. Now this is the north hemisphere and this is the south hemisphere. This is the north pole and this is the south pole. The radius of this sphere is unit. So it's a unit radius sphere. All the quantum states that can exist in this two-dimensional system, and we're talking about special kind of states called pure states. But I will not go into the details of what pure means, but pure quantum states that can be represented by ketes, okay? Are all points on the surface of the sphere. Each quantum state pure quantum state that can be represented by a cat lives on the surface of this sphere. Okay. Now this is the North Pole. Let's call the state that lives on this point or the North Pole, let's suppose that that state is plus Z. Okay. Let's suppose that now if I fix this, the North Pole corresponds to plus Z, the South Pole would correspond to the state that is orthogonal to this. Okay, and that's minus Z. So these points that are on opposite sides of the diameter, that are diametrically opposed, they are orthogonal states. Okay. Now this is the equatorial plane. And this is the equator. Okay. It's a meridian on the equator. The zero latitude. So this point is bilkul samne. Which is at zero longitude. This point is labeled as X. Okay. And this X, of course, is an equal superposition of plus Z and minus Z. You all know this. So this plus X is an equal superposition of Z and minus Z. If this is X, the state X, then the point is on the diameter and opposite to the state will be the state that is orthogonal to this. So you go to the back of the sphere and identify this point here. This will be minus X, state minus X, because plus X and minus X are orthogonal. This state we call y. What's orthogonal to y? X minus y. Every quantum state in a two-dimensional limit space lives on this Bloch sphere. If you want to talk about classical polarization, then I can say that this state is ket h, this state is ket b. This state is ket h plus ket b, right? Ket h plus ket b under root 2, which is just the 45 degrees polarization, right? This state would be the minus 45 degrees polarization. Okay? What would this state be?
L n r.
This would be ket l. This would be ket r. Because this ket y, as you already know, equals 1 over under root 2 z plus iota minus z. Let me redraw this block because it's getting very cluttered here. If I call this state ket alpha and I call this state ket beta, it doesn't harm. So quantum mechanics gives you a description that is independent of the physical realization. A spin half system has the same quantum mechanical description as the polarization of a photon. Okay, because both of them live in a two-dimensional Hilbert space, you just need to identify the basis states. Okay. So I can call these basis states ket alpha and ket beta. Right? Somebody? So the basis is now spanned by ket alpha and ket beta. Or you can also write z and minus z. Doesn't matter. This state that's here is ket alpha plus ket beta under root 2. Right at 0 degrees longitude. the state at 180 degrees longitude, right at the back, the Pacific Ocean of the Earth, which is normally the Earth like this, this is alpha minus beta under root. Now this state is kept by, which is get alpha plus iota beta and root 3. This state is get alpha minus iota under root beta, get beta over under root 2. So it's orthogonal to this state. Any two points that are along the diameter and opposite to one another, which means diametrically opposite points, they correspond to orthogonal states. Now, if I take any point on this sphere, how many states can exist on this block sphere? Infinitely, right? So, if I take any point on this sphere, this is the center of the sphere. Now, this point P, right, must correspond to some state. Okay? Let's call this state ket n. Okay? Ket n. Do is I can, since I'm on the surface of a sphere, I can use spherical coordinates to describe points on the sphere. And since the radius is 1, I don't need to care about the radius. I just need two parameters. Theta and phi. Okay? So I have this theta. Let's call this angle theta, which is the angle of co-latitude measured from the line that connects with the north pole. I project this point onto the xy plane, onto the equatorial plane, and find this angle. Let's call it phi. So this is an azimuthal angle and this is an angle of co-latitude. Right? Angle of co-latitude. And this is an azimuthal angle. Now, how many real parameters do I have to describe? How many real parameters do I need to describe a quantum state? What are those three? Theta, theta, phi, and so you do points. Radius is fixed at 1. So I need, and theta is real, phi is real. I only need two real values to describe a quantum state.
And then I add
so let's look at point P. In spherical coordinates, what are the coordinates of point P? What's the x coordinate? The x coordinate, point P, the x coordinate is sine theta cosine phi, right? The y coordinate is sine theta sine phi. And the z coordinate is cosine theta. Okay, in spherical coordinate, if I take this to be the x-axis, if I take this to be the y-axis, right? So these are the coordinates of point P. Sine theta, cosine phi, sine theta, sine phi, cosine theta. All comfortable with this? Okay. Now, what we are interested in is knowing what is the quantum state that corresponds to P. So this P is given by a set of theta and phi. Every part of the Bloch sphere is defined by these two real numbers. Okay. If I write ket n as cosine theta alpha plus sine theta e I alpha e I phi beta, then is this the correct description for a quantum state? Suppose I would like to look at this state, the x state. which is an equal to proposition of alpha and beta. What's the value of theta here? What's the value of theta at this point? It's pi by 2. But this state is get alpha plus get beta. If I put cosine of pi by 2, this vanishes. So what I would like to do rather is to put an over 2 here and an over 2 here. ये वाला फॉर्म ये वाला एक फॉर्म है ठीक है इफ आई वुड लाइक टू लुक एट दिस स्टेट ओके व्हाट्स द वैल्यू ऑफ थीटा हियर जीरो सो एट दिस पॉइंट दिस टर्म गोज टू जीरो नो मैटर व्हाट द वैल्यू ऑफ फाई इज फाई इज इनडिटरमिनेट इफ दिस इज जीरो यू कैन नॉट डिटरमाइन व्हाट फाई इज दिस इज जीरो बट दिस बिकम्स कोसाइन ऑफ जीरो व्हिच इज वन यू गेट गेट एल्फा So this point is correctly described by this description. Let's look at this point. Here theta is 180 degrees. So when this is 180 degrees, this becomes 90, this vanishes, this becomes sine of 90, which is 1. Sine of 90, which is 1. EI phi, at the north and the south pole, phi, they become indeterminate. Right? So, you just take phi to be 0 at least north and so these are tricky points. So at these points you take phi to be 0 to get theta, get the other state. Now let's look at this point. At this point, theta is 90 degrees. So I put 90 degrees here, this becomes cosine of 45 degrees. This becomes 1 over under root 2. This also becomes 1 over under root 2. And phi at this point is 0. So this becomes 1. So I get alpha plus get beta over under root 2. I reproduce this thing. At this point, my theta is 90 degrees and my phi is also 90 degrees. So this becomes 1 over under root 2 cosine of 45. Sine of 45 is 1 over under root 2 EI pi, pi by 2, which is iota. So I get this iota. Let's look at this point P. This point P is also given by this prescription. So any point on the Bloch sphere is represented by two real parameters theta and phi. And this sphere is called the Bloch sphere. The Bloch sphere represents all the possible quantum states in a two-dimensional system. Now if I have this point P, I would like to find the state that is orthogonal to this n. So I would like to find the state minus n such that the inner product of n and minus n is 0. So I would like to find the orthogonal state. So that state will be on the opposite side of the Bloch sphere, diametrically opposed. Now if I choose the value theta to lie between 0 and pi and phi to lie between 0 and 2 pi. Then in order to find the orthogonal state, what do I need to do? I would like to replace theta by, what should I replace theta by?
Theta 2 pi by 2. Theta plus pi.
Theta plus pi by 2?
Pi.
Theta plus pi?
2 pi minus theta.
2 pi minus theta? I can't do theta plus pi because if I am here, I do theta plus pi, I become here. But this state is not orthogonal to this state. I cannot do theta plus pi. I would like to do pi minus theta. And phi has to be replaced by phi plus pi. If I perform this transformation, I can go to a diametrically opposite point. Let's look at this. If I am here, I want to go to the back. So theta is 90. I would like to keep theta still 90 because 180 minus 90 is still 90. So I would like to remain on the equatorial plane. But I would like to shift phi by 180 degrees. So from here I go back to here. Right? So phi is translated by pi. And theta is change by pi minus theta. So I go from here to here. If I am here, my theta is still 90 degrees, right? Because I am on the equatorial plane. I would like to go here. I don't want to change my value of theta, but I would like to advance my pi by pi. So I go to the west point. This is the east point. If I am here, I would like to go here. So if this angle is 45 degrees, what I would like to do? I would like to go here, so that this angle is 45 degrees, and I would like to move back by pi. If I am, okay, let's draw this block space in a different way. If this is my z axis, this is z, this is x, right? Now I am looking at this block space from here. So I am looking at this plane. So this is the plane that I have, z and x. I am, suppose I am here at 10 degrees. Okay? I would like to go to this point. What do I need to do? I would like to change this 10 degrees to 80 degrees. So I come here. This is 80 degrees, which is simply 180 minus 10, which is 170, right? Sorry. I would like to change this 10 to 170 degrees, and I would like to move back by pi. So I'm at 10 degrees. I go to 170 degrees in the southern hemisphere and move back by pi. So I come here. So I would like to make this transformation. Theta I would like to transform to pi minus theta, and phi I would like to transform to phi plus pi. So if I make this transformation, my orthogonal state minus n is simply going to be cosine of pi minus theta over 2 cat alpha plus sine of pi minus theta over 2 e pi phi plus phi beta, right? This is equal to sine theta over 2. Because cosine of 90 sine theta plus sine of theta by 2, right? Okay, at alpha. This is sine of 90, cosine of plus cosine of theta by 2. And what is this? Ei phi plus phi. What is Ei phi plus phi? It's minus Ei phi, right? Now can you check if this state is orthogonal to this state? Very easy to do that. Get the inner product, minus n, n sine theta over 2 bra alpha minus cosine theta over 2 e minus I phi bra theta inner product with cosine theta over 2 alpha plus sine theta by 2 e plus I phi theta. Now the inner product of alpha with itself is 1, so I get sine theta by 2 cosine theta by 2. The inner product of alpha with beta is 0 because these states are orthogonal to start off with. The inner product of this with this gives me minus sine theta cosine pi by 2, and the answer is 0. Hence, this state is orthogonal to this state. So points on the Bloch sphere are actually quantum states. Now these quantum states could be anything. They could correspond to the horizontal and vertical polarization states of a single photon, the spin angular momenta of spin half particle, they could correspond to an electron that exists on a quantum dot or it doesn't exist on a quantum dot. They could represent the path of a photon because it has two orthogonal states, it's a two-dimensional system. You could have a superconducting quantum interference device which current is circulating in one direction or in the other direction. These are the two basis states. So any physical system that you can talk about which is two-dimensional can be modeled by a Bloch state. If you have an ion in which the energy levels are quantized and you just take two levels, and if the electron is present in this level you call it ket alpha, the electron is present in this level you call it ket beta, then these two levels also form a two-dimensional quantum system and they can be modeled by the Bloch sphere. So this two-level quantum system in quantum computing is also called a qubit. So states can always be represented, pure states can always be represented by points on the Bloch sphere. Now the last 10 minutes, something really inspiring, something that inspired at least me. If you have a two-level quantum system, yeah, that can be modeled as a qubit. And you just ignore the other levels and there are no transitions to the other levels. You see, the role of a teacher is very difficult because there is so much to be told, but things have to be told at the proper juncture. So this is why teaching is so complicated and beautiful at the same time. अरे मैंने बड़े बड़े डरते डरते बात की थी आई एन की, क्योंकि इसके पीछे एक पूरी एक कहानी छुपी हुई है. And I choose the right-hand convention of defining positive and negative angles. So if this operator, now this must be an operator, it acts on an alpha, I should get some output. Now by looking at the Bloch sphere, what output should I get? If I use the right hand rotation, my thumb points in the axis of rotation, where should I go? I should land up here. Okay? So after the action of this operator, I start from here and this operator shifts the state to this point. Okay, I end up here. And this state is minus y, or it's alpha minus iota beta under root 1, right? This is what I end up with. So this operator acts on the initial state to give me this final state. Likewise, if I started off with cat beta and I had this, the same operator act on cat beta, where would I end up here? I would end up here. So my state is here, my axial rotation is there, I rotate, I end up on the east cardinal point. So this state is, the final state is going to be cat alpha plus iota cat beta under root 1. Likewise, I can have rotation about the x-axis, rotation about the y-axis and so on. Suppose I start off with the state cat alpha plus cat beta under root 2 and I do a rotation about the z-axis through 45 degrees. What should be the output? Yes.
Alpha
plus iota beta. Alpha minus iota. So I end up here, right? I end up at this point. So this is 45 degrees. So my phi is 45 degrees and my theta is still 90 degrees. So my output state will be cosine of 45 degrees, which is 1 over under root 2, alpha plus sine of 45 degrees because theta is still 90, 1 over under root 2 e I pi by 4, because now my pi is 45 degrees, cat theta. Okay. So this is my quantum state. You want to
change.
Sir, अगर ये z axis is the axial rotation, angle ये किस theta होता है? ये किस theta होता
है? जैसे अभी हमें phi change हो रहा है, तो यहाँ से z है, यहाँ से zero phi change हो रहा है. अगर theta change हो रहा है, तो axis क्या होगा?
Theta change नहीं होता. अगर तो ये आपका axis of rotation है. देखो ये इनपुट स्टेट ठीक है, ये आउटपुट स्टेट ठीक है. अब आपको क्या पता है कि इसकी क्या फॉर्म, वो तो मैं आपको बताऊंगा तो पता चलेगा, बट दिस इज द आउटपुट स्टेट ठीक है. अब आपका इकरा का सवाल कि इफ आई रोटेट बाय थीटा, इफ आई हैव आर जी अबाउट एनी एंगल फाई एंड माय इनपुट स्टेट इज कैट अल्फा, will my state change? Now my axis of rotation is the same as the state is along the axis of rotation. So the new state will be also be cat alpha, even though there could be some global phase factor. Remember, global phase factors can always pop in, but they are immaterial physically. They can always pop in. So now what we would like to do in the next lecture is we would like to find out the form of these rotation operators. Okay, what are the representation of these matrix operators, and do they depend upon the angular momentum, the spin operators? All right. So this is something. But last question: are these operators unitary? Yes. Like all rotation operators, these operators have to be unitary. All right. So best of luck for your midterm. If you have any questions, email me or come and see me on Friday.